don't even know how to tell you thank you for coming today. It is a gorgeous day outside, isn't it? I'm talking about like turn an atheist into a Baptist kind of gorgeous. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I mean, like, you will believe there's a God when you walk outside on a day like this. It is gorgeous out there. And I ask you to come inside this building. I know it. I know it. So I'm not going to keep you more than an hour. I'm kidding. You know, on the piece of paper, it says, I have 15 minutes. That's what it says on the piece of paper. Oh, gosh. I'm always so happy at Confluence because I look around and I see the faces of people I don't know. And that's a good sign because normally the people who come here are people who are really seriously in, if you know what I'm saying. And if I see people who are seriously in and yet I don't know them, it means that something's happened since the last time we got together, you know? So I want to ask a question, I'm just interested in you responding by, I don't know, like West Kentucky hoot and holler or applause or something. And I only want you to do this if it's real, okay? I want to know how many people are a Christ follower and have become a Christ follower in the last 5 years. Like in the last 5 years, got serious about walking with Jesus, and I'm wanting to see if I can hear you. You know, like anybody the last 5 years seriously walking with Jesus. This is a new thing. Come on now. Okay. See, those of you who've been Christians a long time, we have worn off on them too quickly. Okay, so let me ask you, how many of you would say God has done something genuinely, just very special in my life that has caused me to love him more, be more dedicated to him, draw closer to him? You know, I am more serious about my faith than I've ever been before. Let's say maybe that happened in the last year. How many of you would say, in my life, in the last year, Jesus has done something really special and drawn me closer to him, and my life's new because of him in the last year? Who? Anybody other? Yeah. Oh, that's cool. That's cool. That's testimony is what that is. That's cool. Now, if you did not shout, stand up, yell, or if you did not have reason to do that, do not be disappointed or frustrated or think, man, I wish God had revolutionized my life in the last 12 years, because here's the deal. Over a 30 or 40 or 50 year relationship with Jesus, just to be very honest, you're not going to have earth-shattering, life-altering life change every year. You're probably not going to, you know. But every few years, at least in my experience, every few years, it seems to be that it takes me just about that long to forget the last one. You know what I mean? And God does something that really grabs my attention and draws me back to him. Now, I wish this were easier than it is, but in my life, usually those life-altering, earth-shattering kind of moments the entire story is not happy. You know? Like, it didn't begin with marshmallows and balloons and end with marshmallows and balloons, and God made me better because of it. It usually involves tears and not sleeping well and reading the Bible because you can't find the answers to a major question in your life and getting angry about something. You know what I'm saying? It's usually all of that stuff. And in the midst of that, on the other end of it, you meet Jesus. And I'm afraid that one of the greatest challenges in the lives of many Christians is that they don't make it through the process. It gets tough and they get angry and they get tense and they get worried and bothered. And it's so easy, isn't it, to just quit. And I don't necessarily mean quit church or quit the outward expression of Jesus. I just mean quit the struggle. So that instead of moving through the struggle and meeting Jesus, we just kind of bow out for like normal churchgoer life, you know? The questions are too hard to answer, so I'll just assume that I don't need to know the answers. Or the struggle leads me too hard, so I won't risk the struggle. You see what I'm saying? And all of a sudden, it becomes for many people just kind of a normal rhetoric of calling yourself a Christian and going to church on Sundays, but really, honestly, when you look at your life, you can't remember the last time that you were so full of love for God that it kind of was the primary thing you were thinking about. And in your life, maybe it's been 10 years or 20 years or 30 years since your passion for Jesus was something you couldn't stop thinking about. And I just want to ask you to consider that. You see, these talks at Confluence are really special to me because I'm not tied into a series. I'm not worried too much about what we said last week or what we're going to say next week. I just get to talk to you about what's in here. And the staff and the team of leaders have just kind of asked me to let whatever's in my heart, you know, just kind of toss it out there. And so I want to share you the thing I'm most afraid of as a pastor. And I'm not up here like making a presentation, writing a sermon. I'm telling you, I'm letting you into my counseling session right here, okay? This is the thing that I'm most afraid of. And I'm really afraid of it. I'm not like pastorally speaking most afraid of it. I mean, genuinely, I'm really afraid of this. I'm really afraid that on my day of judgment, looking at Jesus, this is something he'll want to talk about. And that's this. I'm really afraid sometimes that we can pump out like great sermons and we can pump out great worship services and we can do things that make people smile and we can get people excited. And when people are choosing between five churches, ours goes to the top and they pick us, you know. And in the long run, we just become another place for complacent Christians to hang out. I'm really afraid that when we have 500 people on a Sunday morning gathering spread out over four campuses, that I might preach, or whoever's speaking, like Caleb did this morning at the Lake Paducah campus, that we might preach to 500 people, but there might only be 50 listening. I'm really afraid that we might sing songs about how Jesus is our priority and then not think about Jesus until the next Sunday when we're singing songs about he's our priority. Am I making any sense? And I'm not coming tonight to like lay this on you as a guilt trip because you're the ones who came on Sunday night to Confluence. You know what I mean? If there are 50 listening out of 500, most of them are in this room, you know, so I'm not. My fear is that it's really hard to see, and very rare, mind you, to see like radical life change. Like somebody is all about themselves, and then they meet Jesus, and now they're all about Jesus, and it lasts more than a week. You know? Am I making any sense? And so